The nozzle temperature of a 3D printer is usually one of the first parameters you tweak when tuning in a new material. The impact on print quality is generally quite noticeable, with more stringing at higher temperatures. But have you ever wondered how your part strength changes, especially layer adhesion? This is what I tested for PLA and PETG in a temperature range of 190 degrees Celsius up to 270 degrees Celsius. Is there a sweet spot, or is hotter always better? Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. A part of this video is sponsored by Audible. Support the channel and get your free audiobook today by visiting audible.com/cnckitchen. Nozzle temperature is the first parameter that you usually set for a filament. Manufacturers often provide a range of temperatures in which the material can be printed. Some just select the middle of that range and print with it. But I'm sure most of you have already printed one of the various temperature test towers that are available. While printing them, you set different temperatures for each step, which can be, for example, done in Prusa Slicer by inserting the custom G-code M104, S, and then the temperature. I usually start at the highest and work my way up to the lowest, because the chance that the print fails is usually higher at lower temperatures. Once finished, you select the temperature at which the print results look the best, with minimum stringing, nice overhangs and bridges, and smooth surfaces. But that's just part of the story. And before we continue, I'd be interested how you usually select your nozzle temperatures. So post a comment down below. Oh, and if you enjoy these investigations, make sure to subscribe and select the notification bell. Because I have already done some investigations in the past on the topic, I knew that usually at higher temperatures, layers fuse together better. What I tend to do on 3D Maker Noob's temperature towel, which is the one that I usually use, is I break the spikes with my finger to get a feeling if some are harder to break than others. Besides that very rough method of testing, I wanted to properly find out if printing hotter always means better layer adhesion, or if at some point we run into material degeneration and therefore make the print weaker. To test that, I printed quite a lot of my mini tensile test specimens in their standing orientation, because that lets us later judge layer adhesion. I printed 4 samples for each temperature on my original Prusa Mark III. To find out what really happens to the base polymer, I also printed lying specimens, where only the pure material strength is tested. This video covers PLA and PETG, both from dust filament. We already know from another video that at lower temperatures we often under extrude due to the back pressure in the nozzle. This caused samples at higher temperatures to be heavier than once printed colder. More material usually means more strength. Even so, I kind of compensate for that by measuring every test section of the samples before the test. This can also have other side effects. So after printing the first set of samples, I printed a second batch with slightly adjusted flow settings, so that all parts weigh the same, plus minus 1%. For PLA, I tried extrusion temperatures from 190 degrees Celsius all the way up to 270 degrees Celsius in 20 Kelvin increments. And for PETG, I went from 200 degrees Celsius to 260 degrees Celsius in 15 Kelvin increments. Interestingly, the first set of PLA samples printed at 190 degrees Celsius were way under extruded. Increasing flow only caused the extruder to jam, so we can see that we are already right at the lower temperature limit. With varying temperatures, we can already see significant difference in the looks of our prints, especially in the amount of stringing. The higher the temperature, usually the worse the quality. I also printed 3D benches at different temperatures, and they showed the same. Great looking prints at low temperatures. Some materials will even end up with a matte texture when you print them cold and fast. The high temperature parts, though, are quite stringy and even show voids and bubbles on the surface. But let's start with the mechanical tests. The samples were loaded one after the other into my DIY universal test machine, to which plans I, by the way, linked down below. I then loaded the samples at a constant speed until they failed. The reference strength of a PLA sample printing lying is just around the 60 megapascal mark. The more interesting results will now be the samples that I printed standing. The PLA samples printed at 190 degrees Celsius failed on average at 20 megapascals, but keep in mind that I had some issues with extrusion here. Next came the ones printed at 200 degrees Celsius. They were already significantly stronger and failed at 37 megapascals. The 210 degrees parts failed at 39 megapascals and the 230 degrees Celsius at 40 megapascals. Now it became more interesting. The 250 degrees Celsius coupons showed a drop in strength and were only able to bear 37 megapascals. The ones printed at the highest temperature of 270 degrees Celsius dropped even more off and failed at only 32 megapascals. So all in all, pretty interesting results. Let's see how PETG does. The reference strength of PETG when printed lying was 55 megapascals, so a slight bit lower than PLA, but this material usually yields more and sometimes even doesn't break at all and is therefore tougher. My layer adhesion samples usually don't yield a lot before they break, and the standing PETG samples printed at 200 degrees Celsius already broke at 18 megapascals, which is only one third of the reference strength. The 215 degrees samples were stronger and failed at 22 megapascals on average. The 230 degrees parts already showed 55% of the reference strength and failed at 30 megapascals. The parts printed at 245 degrees Celsius, which is already a bit over the recommended range of my DAS filament PETG, were even a bit stronger and reached 60% of the reference strength, so 32 megapascals. The last dog bone samples manufactured at 260 degrees Celsius were once again weaker and failed at 24 megapascals on average. So all in all, a really nice strength versus printing temperature curve for both materials. We can clearly see that if we print too cold, layer adhesion is reduced because the new layer of material is too cold to properly fuse to the existing material. Though if we print too hot, this will degenerate layer adhesion as well. I'm not 100% sure why this is the case. Previously, I thought that the material itself degenerates, but I also tested just simple lying samples at various temperatures. There, changes in strength were not huge, so even those high temperatures don't seem to affect the material noticeably. I think moisture and therefore bubbles forming might affect the layer boundary, but maybe you have a better explanation for that phenomenon. Generally speaking, I think we can summarize the results as follows. If you want to optimize your parts for looks, rather go to the lower end of the recommended temperature scale. If you want to optimize your prints for strength, go to the upper limit and even a bit above. Keep in mind that emissions from the material also usually rise with higher temperatures, even up to the point that your material can decompose. Working with dry filament should always be a high priority because that can ensure consistent, well-looking and also strong print results, even at elevated temperatures. But how about you? How are you usually tuning your temperatures for different applications? Let us know in the comments. The recent tests of SpaceX Starship SN8 again sparked my excitement for spaceflight and Mars exploration, and I just had to re-listen to The Martian by Andy Weir, where the astrobotanist Mark Watney is stranded on Mars and needs to find a way to survive and get back home. Once again, forget the movie and listen to the audiobook because it's probably the most well-researched but also entertaining audiobook on that topic. Since Audible is sponsoring this part of the video, they are offering you a 30-day free trial in which you can listen to this or any other audiobook for free and get full access to their Plus catalog. Audible has an unmatched selection of titles from any genre you can think of. With the holiday season getting closer and closer, Audible also makes a great gift for your relatives and friends. For years, I've been gifting Audible subscriptions to my brother because I'm horrible and always late in choosing gifts. And with Audible, I was always sure that he enjoyed it and could choose titles that interested and excited him. Support the channel and start a free trial at audible.com/cnckitchen, or if you're in the US, text cnckitchen to 500-500. I have to admit that I already started listening to titles that just weren't for me, but with Audible's no questions asked exchange policy, I was always able to return them and choose something different. One title I'm sure you won't be returning is The Martian by Andy Weir, to which you should definitely listen if you want to, for example, find out how to grow potatoes on Mars. Visit audible.com/cnckitchen for your free trial now. Thank you, Audible, for sponsoring part of this video. Thanks for watching, everyone, and welcome to my new, still a bit echoey studio. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you subscribe for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, or maybe even buy some merch. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.